Please call the roll.
Commissioner Anderson?
Present.
Commissioner Bennett?
Here.
Commissioner Nanki?
Here.
Commissioner Dickey?
Here.
Commissioner Benjamin?
Here.
Commissioner Bednarz?
Here.
Commissioner Lewis?
Here.
Commissioner Caravaggio is absent. Chair McCoy?
Here. Please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. We have no additions or deletions to the agenda, so is there any public comment?
There's no one signed up.
No one signed up. Does anybody here have any public comment you'd like to make for the housing authority? Seeing none, we'll move along. Commissioner Lewis, do you have a motion for me in the consent calendar?
I do. I move passage of the consent calendar.
Second.
Excuse me, Chair McCoy, yes, I believe I pulled something.
I just got to it.
Okay, good. Just checking.
I apologize.
That's all right.
Commissioner Lewis. Commissioner Anderson wants to pull 3-2-A.
Too late. Oh, no, that's okay. Then I move passage of the consent agenda with 3.2A pulled by Councillor Anderson.
Second again.
Commissioner Anderson.
It's been moved and seconded that we approve the consent calendar with the following poll, 3.2A by Commissioner Anderson. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. Commissioner Lewis, do you want to talk about the other items on the consent calendar?
Well, yes, they're 3.2B is the regarding the Robert Lindsay Tower, and it's been revised to be compliant with HUD and tax credit regulatory requirements, as well as addressing revisions that cover activities subject to eligibility, denial, termination, and eviction. So this is the rule book on that. 3.2C is adoption of a revised South Fair tenant selection plan, and this is the rule book on that. And then lastly is 3.4A, and that is the project management report that has been submitted by Housing Administrator Wilch.
Which is much thinner.
Yeah.
Okay. Special orders of business, Council.
Take action on that.
We have to keep, didn't we vote?
Vote on the consent calendar.
Thought we voted.
But we have a motion.
We did vote on it before we actually discussed what was on it.
Yeah, I screwed it up. So we're to special orders of business. Commissioner Anderson, do you have a motion?
Yes, I do. I move we adopt Resolution 2191, adopting revisions to the public housing ACOP revised as of July 11th, 2016.
We have a second. Yeah. So moved and seconded to pass item 3.2A. All those in any discussion?
I have some discussion.
Yes.
I have a question or two for Councillor, for Director Wilch. As I read these and also the 3.2B and 3.2C, which are all pretty much under the same rule requirements of HUD, all you have done to us in all these pages is just highlighted about six changes or four to six that you've made in each one, correct?
That is correct.
Okay, and I some of them are the same all the way through, but some of them are a little different. And I'm wondering if you could talk about why we have the differences in the different plans, please.
So there are three different plans that are before you today. The public housing, admissions and continued occupancy policy. That comes from public housing, 1937 Housing Act. It's a different animal than the other ones. Robert Lindsay Tower is under the HUD multifamily programs. And South Fair is a combination of home funds, federal funds, deep subsidy rental vouchers, and tax credits. So they all have unique and different, some overlap, but some different policy aspects that we have to make sure we're implementing.
Thank you very much. I will note that I looked at criminal criteria for eligibility as revised, and those are pretty interesting, ranging from you can't do anything till you give us these, like your social security number and other items, or all the way up to you're barred for life. And I think that's a good thing to have those delineated for your staff and how you're helping with the people who need the help.
Could I comment on that real quick?
Please.
So HUD has come out with a lot of changes to fair housing, and it's called furthering fair housing. And in that document, they've gone to great lengths to demonstrate data points that suggest that in some cases, criminals that we may have barred from getting into housing over a period of time or after a period of waiting time, that they may or may not likely not make that same crime again. And so HUD is putting a lot of effort into that. So I think that we'll see more of furthering fair housing, and we'll be asked to implement more in our documents to make sure that we're giving fair opportunities for folks that have been in prison.
Very good. Thank you. That's all I have.
Commissioner Bednar.
So I have two questions or two statements. Question and then a statement, I should say. I, too, spent quite a bit of time on the violation chart, and my concern was on some of them, they're strict enough that it might prevent some people from finding housing. We're working very strongly at this point trying to figure out our homeless problem in this community, and there's a fair number that, I mean, if nothing else, they're out of housing, supported housing for 3, 5, 7, 10, 15 years, depending on the crime that they committed. And those individuals then end up on the street or other locations, which means they may actually redo what they did in the first place. There's no solution for those individuals. Once they do their crime, they've got to pay the time and the price that they had.
Well, the only statutory provisions for denying from a HUD standpoint is the manufacture of methamphetamine and sexual assault, not a sexual assault, a sex crime that they were committed of.
Where they had to register, where they actually registered.
Right, yeah. That's correct.
Yeah.
So.
And murder was the third one.
Right.
The second question or statement I want to is more of a technicality, but if I remember the motion, I think Commissioner Anderson mentioned, I got to get the right title here. Anyway, the staff said on this, in particular one on 3.2A, was adopt resolution number 2190 when it should have been 2191. It says it down below in the recommendation 2191. It's just a typo, but it is a difference, perhaps, maybe in the motion that Commissioner Anderson had made. I don't know. I think you mentioned 2191. That's what brought my attention to it, actually.
I did mention 2191, and that's what it says there. Adopt resolution 2191.
Correct.
Well, so I move we adopt. Yeah,
that's
I move
fine.
We adopt
it's just
the resolution
technicality. The recommendation
3.3A of the agenda.
Okay. Do we have to? So you got the right motion. Okay, so we've got a motion on the floor. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion passes. There is no unfinished business or new business, so this meeting of the Housing Authority of the City of Salem is adjourned.
Well, good evening, everyone. I'd like to introduce myself. I'm Mayor Anna Peterson, and I'm going to be chairing the Urban Renewal Agency meeting as well as the Salem City Council meeting. So welcome. We'll begin the Urban Renewal Agency meeting for Monday, July 11th, 2016. Would our recorder please call the roll?
Board Member Bennett?
Is Bennett here?
He's here.
Board Member Anderson?
Here.
Board Member Nanki?
Here.
Board Member McCoy?
Here.
Board Member Dickey?
Here.
Board Member Benjamin?
Here.
Board Member Bernards?
Here.
Board Member Lewis?
Here.
Chair Peterson?
Here. Thank you. Our first item of business is to look for a motion for approval of additions and deletions, if we have any. Member McCoy, do we have any for today?
We have none for the urban renewal meeting.
Okay, then we'll move right along. No boards and commission reports. It's time for public comment. Has anyone signed up? No one. Is there anyone in the chambers that did come this evening to speak during public comment for the Urban Renewal Agency? All right, I see no one for that. Then, Member McCoy, I would entertain a motion for the consent calendar.
I move approval of the consent calendar.
Second.
It's been moved by Member McCoy and second by Member Bednarz. Member McCoy, do you have comments on the consent calendar?
Yes, I do. We have, oops. We have the minutes, basically, the minutes of the June 6th and June 27th meeting on the consent calendar.
That's it.
That's it.
All right, we have a, thank you. We will vote then on the consent calendar to accept the consent calendar. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, say nay. Thank you, motion carries unanimously. We will move to resolutions 4.2. Resolutions and action items were covered under the consent calendar. We will move to information reports, and I will ask if there are any questions about the information reports that are both at 5A and 5B. Yes, Member Anderson.
Thank you very much. Chairperson?
Yes.
Yes, okay. Wanted to make sure I had that title right.
Got it right.
Yes. I have some questions for Ms. Rutherford, and we had a little brief discussion off the record, as it were. And I have some questions about infrastructure fees and how closely related are they to systems development charges? Because it seems like that's kind of what you're using, a system development charges in the city and non-urban renewal areas comparing to infrastructure fees in urban renewal areas.
In the Mill Creek area, when it was established as an urban renewal area, and we entered into our intergovernmental agreement with the Department of Administrative Services, we instituted what's known as a development district fee in lieu of a system development charge that we would have elsewhere in the city. System development charges cannot be applied to deficiencies in infrastructure. They're all tied to expansion and growth in new infrastructure. Mm-hmm. In this area, we've got state-owned property, and we also have some deficiencies in infrastructure that need to be addressed. So instead of using the system development charges that we use elsewhere in the city, we established this development district so that developers would pay a fee that is comparable to the system development charge, but could be used for projects that SDCs can't normally be used for.
And then I see that your report, staff report, indicates that originally it was $2.76 per square foot, which was the equivalent of the SDCs, and over time, due to the structure, it's now risen to $3.72 per square foot.
Right, and I would say it was similar to the system development charge, because system development charges are based on impacts and types of uses. In the development district, it's a straight square foot fee, independent of types of use or impact.
Then, one of the things that you said in your report, that there was a concern that maybe some developers weren't wanting to come into Mill Creek because of the higher infrastructure fees. Is you know, how solid is that kind of information, or is it speculation or chat or what?
No, those are comments that we received from developers when they would look at Mill Creek. Then they would look at other areas of the city and say, you know, we could do the same project somewhere else for less money with paying SDCs instead of the DDS.
So, and what you said, though, is it's developers who are saying, we could develop in Salem proper, or we could develop in Mill Creek. So it's not someone who's saying, we could develop in Mill Creek, or we could develop in Corvallis, or we could develop someplace else.
Correct. They've raised that question as they're looking at Mill Creek. Why is it more expensive here than elsewhere in Salem?
But the people who have raised that question, who are people who are planning to be in Salem already, not comparing the Urban Renewal District Salem with some other Urban Renewal District?
I am not aware of others that have asked that question in relation to Mill Creek compared to other cities.
Okay.
No, because our fees overall are less than what most other areas.
That's a good segue into my next question. One of the things you said is that our fees are still lower than, you said system development charges in Portland, and you meant to say system development charges. Okay. Portland, Hillsboro, and Wilsonville. Is that at the 276 per square foot, or the equivalent of 276 per square foot, because it's not based on square feet like the infrastructure charges are, or is it at the 372 per square feet?
I'd say that even at our higher amount, that's still, I'd say, generally true that it's less. I suppose that there could be some developments in those other communities that are your least impactful and least generating the lowest amount of SDC fees that we could be closer to, but kind of project for project, you know, on average, we would still be lower at the higher amount.
So is there anything that the urban renewal, putting a development in the urban renewal agency at the higher fee would give the developers who want to locate in Salem that they wouldn't get if they located in a non-urban renewal district with the lower SDCs?
Larger parcels for development.
Okay. So, you know, that's something they may want to look at and said, we have a project that is this big and the only place we can put it in is an urban Mill Creek, and we want to be in Salem, not someplace else.
That's
correct. Okay, so even despite those charges, somebody who wants to develop in Salem might still be able to look at Mill Creek.
Yes.
Then, and this, I guess, is more of a philosophical question. You know, what we've said is that the system development charges or the infrastructure fees should take care of the infrastructure that is being placed in these areas. So does that really happen?
So we look at it as there are different pots of money covering different things. So the infrastructure fee, similar to a system development charge, is the developer's responsibility. Then we also have the public side of thing, the public infrastructure, our responsibility that we pay for either through urban renewal or through grant funding that we receive. And so the project costs are paid for by a mix of these different funding sources.
Well, here's an example we discussed before the meeting. Last month at the June 27th meeting, we were informed that you have an application into SCATS for a grant to take care of stoplight structures at an area, I think Cordon Road and Kubler Boulevard, that is in the Mill Creek Development District, but the infrastructure fees are not paying for that. You're taking that from SCATS grants.
So my understanding of that particular project, and perhaps Director Fernandez could step in, is that that was an interconnect project. So some of the work was in the district, but it connected to work that was also outside of the district. And so that's why the additional grant funding was.
I see Director Fernandez is nodding his head up and down.
Peter Fernandez, Public Works Director. Yes.
Okay.
That is a project that is doing signal interconnect work that it really was never on the Mill Creek list, but it will allow the signal at Mill Creek Parkway, at Omsville Highway, and the new signal that's coming at Gaffin Road to operate better.
I appreciate that, and I understand that. I guess the point that I would make is that that's a SCAT grant that can't be used for something else, and there might have been ways that the infrastructure fees could have been used to pay that. And you know, I guess that's just a comment, and I think that's the end of my question. But what I'm hearing on this is the staff coming to the council and saying, this is what we're doing. I mean, we don't have a chance to vote on this. It's just an information report.
This is an information-only report, Councilor Anderson.
Well, that's what I said. I understand that.
I think that city attorney's going to answer your question.
Okay. Just very briefly, this is the Urban Renewal Agency. It's an information item for the agency. Okay, it'll be an action item for the council.
Oh, got it. Okay, thank you very much. Now I understand, because I saw it was on the council meeting.
Right.
And I don't think I have any other questions. Now I understand. Thank you for reminding me of that.
Thank you. Councilor Nanke had his hand up.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Just because this is one of those weird ones, and Fairview property is also one that's not an urban renewal agency that also pays development district fees. And just because, are there the two of those? And it was because they were owned by the state previously when we originally set SDCs, and so they were not involved in the calculations, and so they have to be different.
Right. Director Rutherford did an excellent, for not having been here for very long, did an excellent job of explaining long history. These two properties were in state ownership when SDCs were developed. We could have turned them into SDC eligible properties because they had a lot of extra needs to develop. A very creative solution was done to be able to address infrastructure issues to support those two properties, development of those two properties, and address issues in the neighborhoods around those two properties that really SDCs, we have our hands tied more if we had just gone SDCs. We did make a point that DDFs shall never be less than what it would cost right. an SDC. So they can be more, but they would never be less.
Just because it's different, I figured people didn't know that.
And you're right, Councilor, just the two, just Fairview and Mill Creek.
Thank you. Are there any questions on other information reports that you see before you, 5B? If not, we'll move along. We have no special orders of business or public hearings and no new business, so this meeting of the Urban Renewal Agency is adjourned. I'd like to call to order this evening's meeting of the City Council for Monday, July 11th, 2016. Would the recorder please call the roll?
Councilor Bennett?
Here.
Councilor Anderson?
Present.
Councilor Nanke?
Here.
Councilor McCoyd?
Here.
Councilor Dickey?
Here.
Councilor Benjamin?
Here.
Councilor Bernards?
Here.
Councilor Lewis?
Here.
Mayor Peterson?
Here. Thank you. Councilor McCoyd, I would entertain a motion for approval of additions and deletions.
Madam Mayor, I move approval of additions and deletions to the agenda.
Thank you. It's been moved by Councilor McCoyd and seconded by Councilor Nanke. Councilor McCoyd, do you have comments on the revisions?
Yes, I do. The additions were revised minutes. There were some, the ones that went out late last week, there were some errors in the minutes, and those were corrected. So the corrected and accurate minutes were included and added to the agenda. Okay. And the deletion was a water supply agreement with the City of Keizer. It's a contract that was going to be an agreement was going to be extended, and that was withdrawn to make sure that all the T's are crossed and the I's are dotted. So that will come up at a future meeting.
All right. Thank you. There's a motion on the floor to approve the revisions to the agenda. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, say nay. Motion passes unanimously. Thank you. We now have time for council and city manager comment. I will entertain councilor comments. Now, usually the hands just shoot right up. Are you all being quiet?
We're trying to remember
Councilor
what we
Dickey.
Wanted to
do.
Thank you, Mayor. I have a couple things. One, I just wanted to report, because I thought this was a great thing. I had a constituent contact me and let me know that downtown bicycle police are enforcing pedestrian traffic rules. Had a situation where a car did not yield to them in a crosswalk, and they observed the bicycle patrol officer then pulling over that car and dealing with the situation. So I was really happy to hear that that is being addressed downtown. So thank you so much to our police for doing that. The other thing I just wanted to bring up, I always forget about this until it's after the 4th of July, but this year I had a lot of comments from people who were concerned about the amount of fireworks, the amount of illegal fireworks, and how late they were going into the middle of the night. I won't be here next year, but I'm just kind of throwing this out there as, you know, this is something I think this council needs to discuss. I'd love to have a conversation with some staff offline to see to just discuss some of the concerns that I've heard. People are reporting, you know, they're hearing illegal fireworks at 3 a.m, which is very concerning, something that was very frightening to their animals and that kind of thing. So just because of the amount of comments I've received, I don't know if others have. So at some point I'd like to talk with staff about that. And you know, I don't know what happens with that, but that is a concern I heard more this year, I think, than any other year I've been here.
Okay, thank you very much. Councilor Anderson.
Thank you. Unfortunately, I'm going to talk about pedestrian deaths again. We've had two of them, one in Keizer and one in Salem, in the past 2 weeks. And both of them were extremely unfortunate, and both of them involved young males, 18-year-old and 20-year-old, very early in the morning, and that's just not a good situation for anybody. And they were both tragedies, and the one I particularly want to talk about is Alex C. Arms, who was an 18-year-old young man who lived in Ward 2 and late at night was crossing Liberty, and he got hit. And it's really a tragedy for Mr. Arms and his family. I happened to, there was a candlelight vigil at the Pioneer Statute in Bush's Pasture Park at 10 o'clock one night. And I went to that and I discussed it with the city manager, and he discussed it then with the chief of police. And just so they could know what was going on. And I was there, and there were about 120 young kids, teenagers to young 20s, and maybe 20 adults. And it was a candlelight vigil. It was very appropriate. It was very heartfelt. 20 or 30 of the kids spoke, and so did some of the adults. And I think it was totally appropriate and very cathartic. And I came by the next morning, and people had left their candles, you know, on the statue, and it was still kind of there, and it looked kind of like a shrine almost. And Mr. Arms' mother was there, and she was quite emotional about the whole thing, and was also quite appreciative of what the city had allowed people to be there and do this. And a few days later, one of the adults who was there and many of the children who were there came by and cleaned up the statue. And I rode my bike by it a couple days ago, and it is the only thing you can see left is some places where you could see on the paving stones around there where candle wax dripped. But the statue looked terrific, and it was actually quite a moving ceremony, and I was very glad to be there. I'm just sorry it had to happen. But once again, we've got some more tragic deaths here, and I'm sorry that those have happened. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Councilor Bennett.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Just a couple of things I ran into yesterday going for a walk down at Riverfront Park. One was the Pokemon Go activity. I don't know if anyone has been following this. It's
nope, everybody.
Yeah, pretty much. That's
except for me.
Except for Dave or Brad. But it was really interesting. We were walking along and noticed an awful lot of people, extraordinarily more people than usual, looking at their cell phones. And just sort of, I commented to my wife, boy, this really is a commentary. And so she decided to find out what the deal was, and it was Pokemon Go, and had someone show it to us. It was really an interesting thing. It's a map of Salem with these little pocket monsters, and it was just kind of fun to look at what was going on, and a whole batch of people of all age groups, a couple hundred, were doing this activity at Riverfront Park and at other parts of Salem, I'm sure, all over town. And then you could hear in the background kind of a small rock festival. It really wasn't that small. It was the River City Rock Fest, which is the end of the River City Rockstar Academy. It's sort of their recital. I use the term recital knowing that this will just really tighten somebody up, but it was kind of the recital of all these different age groups that had been through this Rockstar Academy, and it was really entertaining. Again, a couple hundred people were out to watch that. It was a really good day at the park. Really
great.
Enjoyed it.
Wonderful. Well, I have a comment to thank our city staff and the community for making the 4th of July such a great event in Salem. Riverfront Park was filled with people throughout the day and on into the evening, and we had what so many people said to me that night and in days since, the best fireworks show we've ever had. And it was just an outstanding event. And I was very, very pleased to hear the next day from one of the police officers that not so much as a child was missing. So it was an event with thousands of people and no problems at all. So it was a great evening for everyone. The music was fun and the weather was just really compatible with being outside all day and all evening. So many congratulations to the city staff who worked so hard to make the park ready and afterwards, at the event and afterwards. Many thanks. Other councilor comments? We have comment time for city manager. Oh, sorry, did I forget?
Just a quick
you?
One. In regards, yes. There's been a lot of communication over the last week in regards to the respect level and trust level that our police department has garnered. And just wanted to give a thumbs up to Salem PD.
Absolutely. Absolutely. We have a department we can be proud of.
Very much so.
And we are proud of them. Very proud. City manager, do you have comments tonight?
Well, I have a brief story of a thumbs up for our fire department. We have been using the Pulse Point technology application, speaking of smartphones. It's a technology that alerts CPR-trained bystanders to a cardiac emergency in their immediate vicinity. The first life was saved using that application, and it was by one of our off-duty firefighters.
All right. Good news. Good news. All right. That's pretty amazing. If we have no further counselor comment, we will move along to public comment because we have no proclamations or presentations. And it looks like we have some individuals signed up. Denise Concannon, followed by David Bordelon, perhaps I'm saying that right, I hope. Welcome. And you have 3 minutes to speak. At the end of 2 minutes, the amber light comes on. At the end of 3 minutes, the red light comes on. Welcome. And we need you to state your name and address, please.
My name is Denise Concannon. I own a shop at 1045 Commercial Street Southeast in Salem. I'm here to talk about the repealing of the medical marijuana licensing, specifically the 1,000-foot rule when it comes to shop to shop. I've really appreciated the work that the council has done over the years in putting together a good plan. I think repealing this is a bad move for the city of Salem. If I look around my shop alone, there are 7 or 8 vacant buildings. Those buildings could be employed multiple shops, and I don't think that's a picture Salem wants to have. I think anybody who comes in and says $100 for a license, I can put my shop here, they're going to be here for a while as we work at the rec and then gone. I just think it's a bad move for the city of Salem. Saturation would be a severe issue, I believe. I think I like working with the police. I like working with the city. I like the licensing. I think it helps us all to maintain a certain level of professionalism. The industry is just now growing. Recreational's just now going. I'd ask the city to please hold off on that for a couple years. At least get recreational out and in the community and see what it looks like. I'm not saying put numbers on the number of businesses. I think this is a bad rule to move those borders. I am one that would have a violation of a shop going in across the street from me. I'm okay with that as a business. Dutch Brothers is right next to Breakpoint, which is right by me, and they both do good business. I think I would do good business even with a shop across the street from me. But I am concerned with the number of other available spots and how that would look for the city of Salem. Portland is a large city, and they've even kept that 1,000 foot so that the saturation doesn't happen, because I think you'd have small businesses that would fold. So I'm a small business. I don't want to fold. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Are there questions for Ms. Concannon? Councillor Bennett, followed by Councillor Anderson.
Have you had a chance, you've described the 5 businesses. I really appreciate you coming down talking about this. It's something that I'm still thinking about.
Yeah.
Do you have a sense of what the saturation would look like citywide? Do you have any feel for what that would look
like? I do. So currently, I'm at 1045 Commercial Street.
Okay.
Recently, I knew of an individual who had a grow and had excess medicine who decided to open up a shop across from Roadhouse. He said, well, recreational is here, gloves are off, I'm going to be able to open right here. He's an individual the city does not want to work with, I can assure you. But he'll be able to go in, apply for a $100 permit, and open up a shop right there where there's already congestion. Everybody knows what it's like at Roadhouse. You can hardly find parking as it is. I had to go through the same thing. I had an adjustment, worked with the city, got an adjustment for my parking. Parking in the city of Salem, especially in that area by Bush Park, is really condensed. The shops that could open very easily, I just think this, it would be a bigger problem that the city's asking for than what they want. I really do.
Okay.
But the saturation for me, a good 5 or 6 shops would be able to open right around me within a 2-block radius.
And you're again where?
I'm at 1045 Commercial Street.
What's your cross street?
I'm at Bush and Owens.
Okay.
So I get a lot of the traffic
so
that goes
down. So
you'd
see Owens. 5 shops on Commercial at Bush and Owens.
That could open up, yep.
Okay.
Potentially. I know 2 that are going to have petitioned to open already within a block.
Are there any other parts of town where you've seen that kind of potential?
Yes.
Where else do you see that?
Down on Commercial South. We've definitely seen a lot of movement down there.
Where Commercial South?
Commercial South would be from Madrona. Yeah, the plaza. It's just a lot. I mean, I personally know of multiples who are actually interested in also opening, and they haven't even permitted or anything like that. They just know of places. They're willing to lease to them. And there's a lot of entity that I don't think necessarily the business aspect of it. They have the business aspect of it behind them. They just have product and an availability for $100 to open up a shop.
When you say multiples, I'm not sure I understood what that means.
Say that again?
Did I hear you say the word multiples in describing? I'm not sure I understood what you were saying.
Yeah, multiple people who have talked to me, because I've been doing this for a long time,
okay,
who have given me the information that they're interested in opening up a place, whereabouts, and I just think you guys are looking at super, super saturation because everybody thinks there's a lot of money and a lot of quick, this is an easy, quick business. It's not. Regulations alone, information, we're all still learning and growing. I think the city would do well with where they're at right now.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Councillor Anderson, followed by Councillor McCoy.
Councillor Bennett asked all the questions I was going to ask.
Oh, all right. Thank you. Councillor McCoy?
Hi. Thanks for coming down.
You're welcome.
What kind of problems do you foresee other than a number of them in a you know,
yeah,
smaller area?
Other than the saturation issues, I see an issue with being able to really to cover it, policing it. I know that takes time, record keeping, the city to know who, what, when, and where. We have a number of liquor stores that are covered by OLCC that are watched. We have licensing and permitting of other businesses that I think are good for the city of Salem. I think licensing and permitting of marijuana shops are good. It is a product that can be an illicit product on the street, and so providing that for the city makes the city more comfortable. You don't want shops on every corner. You just don't, and I think it would happen.
Another question.
Yes.
So we're basically saying the OLCC, which, as you so accurately say, mm-hmm. has got a lot of experience policing the alcohol business, both on the retail side and by the drink side, mm-hmm. will be the same folks policing these new businesses as they come on board, and that's who's going to sign them up, that's who's going to vet them, that's who's going to give them their license, and that's who's going to regulate them. So. Mm-hmm. From my point of view, that seems to me that concern's covered, and other than retail competition, which I think is going to weed itself out in a very short order, I haven't heard a problem that I guess I'd be concerned upon.
I think that because OLCC does have a number per capita, they put so many alcohol stores. They're not doing that with the cannabis. And so that concerns me that they're going to regulate alcohol in that respect of per capita, and they're not with shops such as this. I also think if you allow everybody to come in, you're going to get a lot of people from out of state, which we've already seen, a lot of people who have no concern or care about City of Salem itself, who are going to open up shop, and then as soon as California opens, they're going to bail and go down to California, leaving behind an element that the city may not want.
So what would that element be? I'm trying to get to a problem. I haven't heard a problem. I've heard some concerns, but I haven't heard a specific problem that is going to affect the city.
I appreciate that. I think the problem will be with diversion. As much as OLCC will try to regulate it, people will figure a way around it. Currently, they're having a backlog of just sending your inventory to them. I mean, it's a simple problem, but I don't think they have a good grasp on it. That's why I'm not saying don't allow this to happen, but maybe give us a couple years before you completely wipe away 1,000-foot, some of the regulations that you've had, parks, things of that nature. Maybe I am more of a concern than a problem, but I do see that there would be problems.
Mm-hmm. Councillor Dickey.
All right, yeah, thanks for coming down. Just one question. Do you know how much OLCC is charging for a license from them?
It depends on where and what you're doing, around $4,000.
Okay, thanks.
Yep. Thank you very much.
All right, thank you very much. All right, the other person signed up to testify, David Bordelon.
Yes.
Am I saying your name right? All right, hey, I got it right. I want that to be noted in the record. Thank you. Welcome. And you'll have 3 minutes. At the end of 2 minutes, the amber light comes on. And then at the end of 3 minutes, the red light. Welcome.
Thank you, Mayor. My name is David Bordelon. My personal address is over on Argyle Drive South, but I work for Ancient Remedies on State Street. I agree a lot with the person who spoke before me. There definitely are concerns with abolishing the 1,000-foot rule. I guess for me, I don't see much of an advantage for the city. As a business, we enjoy the regulation that we have. We pride ourselves in being a newly regulated industry. We want you guys to have a level of control. We don't want to be the only people in charge of our business. I know it sounds kind of a little strange, but our business is very new. And when customers come in, we like to be able to tell them that we are in total compliance with all state and local laws. That is something that we pride ourselves in. I think it would be a shame to have the system that already works in Salem abolished for, I guess, for no apparent reason. The only benefit seems to be mentioned is the Cole memo, the possibility of not maybe facing some sanctions later on. I think the city should continue doing what it's doing. I think we as a community are benefiting, and we as a business are benefiting. That's all.
Thank you very much. Any further questions from councilors? Councilor Benjamin.
I have a question for staff. Should I wait or ask it now?
You can ask it now.
Okay. So if I understand correctly, the amount of money comes back to the city of Salem from the revenue of sales is part of the matrix is how many dispensaries or recreational marijuana sales points that we have?
Yes, that's correct, Councilor.
So the more that we have, the more money we...
That it works that way exactly.
You said it did.
And I think we will be able to talk about that more under the actual section that has that. Okay, good. Thank you. Thank you for coming down. Appreciate your testimony. All right. Oh, yes. It is. In fact, I was going to just ask if there was anyone else in the chambers that did come down to testify. And if you'll just indicate your name and address when you testify, we'll get that on the record. And I think this gentleman in the back also wanted to. All right, if you'd like to go first, and then if you can follow you. Thank you.
How's everybody doing tonight?
Welcome. Well, I think we're fine.
I didn't plan on speaking tonight. My name's Alicia Smith. I actually manage a shop in North Salem, kind of by the Fred Meyer there. It's called Homegrown Oregon. And I just wanted to, I think you guys were trying to understand what a potential problem would be by abolishing this 1,000-foot law. And I can just tell you from my experience, what I foresee being the issue is that right now with all the competition that's happening, it's forcing us to sell things so cheaply. And the more and more business comes in, it's going to just drive the price down so much that we're not going to be able to afford to sell, you know, what we need to sell to stay in business. And I feel like it's just going to either push so many folks, so many residents into the black market into buying things that they can buy much more cheaply with us trying to keep up with the 25% tax and all the competition. It's just going to, I kind of feel like, cause chaos. And there's a really fine line between figuring out how much we should zone where it makes it impossible to get a space, because there's other places of Salem that we've wanted to go that we just literally can't find a space or a landlord that will rent to us, combined with being so close to someone else that everybody's in competition that the market just goes haywire and then everybody's just buying on the black market. Because honestly, even the 25% tax is so high that people come into our shop and they're like, you know, I can get this for a third cheaper, you know, illegally. And that's what we don't want to happen, and that's what I think is the problem, is that we're just going to drag people into the black market. And I understand your perspective. You know, I'm in business too. You want to make as much money as possible. But what's going to happen is you're going to, so many businesses are going to come in here. There's already big businesses that are coming in and trying to get their foot in the door, and all these community folks and people that have lived in Oregon, it's just going to push us out of business. It's going to drag people into the black market, and it's going to be the Walmart of marijuana. So that's what I foresee the problems being. But with the other zoning, I think that that's, you know, I personally think being near a park and schools, you know, I wish that those things weren't so strict, because it would free up some space and kind of spread things around. But having everybody in these congested areas is just going to make it too challenging, and I think the market would fold. That's my opinion.
Well, thank you for testifying. I think you have some questions here. Councillor Lewis?
Yeah, I think I heard two things. One, too many shops, too much competition, the price will go down. Mm-hmm. And two, it will eventually drive people back to the black market. I would question that. I would think as the competition increases and the price goes down, be more likely that the black market will be pushed out.
Well, I guess what I'm trying to say is that there's only so much that dispensaries can drop their prices to even stay in business and make their margins, because I'm not sure if everyone is aware, but you know, we don't have any federal tax deductions, so we have to pay tax on our gross income. I believe we're the only industry in the entire country that has to do that. So what happens is, you know, everybody that's gotten into this business sees this as a long play, and that, you know, we're really trying to get our feet, you know, kind of in the ground now and just work so that we can stay in business. But when we don't even get to write our employees off, the only deduction that we have is actually just based on our cost of goods. So you can imagine what that is. And then we're also, do we eat the 25% tax that we charge those customers because they don't want to have to pay, you know, a third more than what they're paying on the black market, or do we eat it? But then that just keeps making it harder and harder for small businesses to stay in business. So yes, I guess it's hard for me to articulate, you know, exactly what I mean, but what I think would happen is that small businesses, you know, people that just started without a lot of money, are not going to be able to afford to compete with the person next door that came in with, you know, a couple million dollars of funding that's funded by a Walmart type establishment. It's going to turn into big business. It's going to kick the small businesses out. And eventually, I feel like people that go to these dispensaries, they may not even want to support those big businesses. And it's just going to keep encouraging people to buy illegally. That's what I think would happen.
All right, thank you. Councilor Bednarz?
You actually said exactly what I said when we were working on the ordinance a long time ago, this past year, exactly that I didn't want to raise the taxes so high that it would push it back into the mm-hmm. black market. I was also told repeatedly that there's always going to be a black market no matter what, that we're not going to stop it. I think that the point here is that this council has asked the voters in November about a 3% sales tax on medical marijuana, but the 25% is a state issue, and it's the legislature that you really need to be talking to about saying, hey, I'm trying to level the field between us and the black market. Talk to them. That's really where you need to start, because at this point, we just had this conversation about food carts, whether they should be 250 or 500 feet apart from one another on a street, and it's turned out to be okay. People are surviving anyway. So anyway, I'm just letting you know you're being heard. We talked about that exact issue, but you really need to be talking to the people in the big white building on State Street.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah.
Thank you
guys. But as far as the other zoning issues, I think those should be a little bit more loose, because it would spread the pockets out more among Salem, but just putting a bunch of people right next to each other, I think it's just going to really make it difficult for small businesses.
So this is one of the reasons why we referred it back to some of the guidances from the OLCC rather than some of the strict rules that we had about setbacks, as an example, from a park, which we have one here currently that's been testifying before us a few times. Mm-hmm. Just trying to make it more uniform with what the OLCC will be doing.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for coming down.
Thank you.
Welcome. If you'll state your name and address or your ward, we'll get that into the record, and you have 3 minutes.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Lauren Cruzzi, and my business address is 1295 Oxford Street Southeast, Salem, Oregon. And my farm is in Jefferson, Oregon. So it's really hard to stand up here with my friends on one side over here. And, you know, and I absolutely felt that when we started this process several years ago with the OHA and the dispensary program here in Salem, that I had no idea why we were making ordinances. We already had a state agency that was going to govern us and take care of that. And we have been all put through so much, so many different levels of bureaucracy to have to deal with when we already knew that the OHA was there. And we all voiced that at this very committee meeting at that time. Coming back and watching our city attorney put together a great ordinance for this council, and then to see it tossed out the window last week, I was just like, oh my God, you know, we're right back where we were 2 years ago. We have OLCC, they'll take care of this program. You know, and I gotta say something to you, counselor. You said that black market's always gonna continue. You know why the black market continues? Is because we're not protected as businesses from the black market. People can go on Facebook and sell whatever they want. You contact your police department and they don't do anything, okay? I mean, there's literal shops on Facebook in Albany and Salem, okay, that are selling stuff. And we're not protected, okay? If somebody was making moonshine and selling it out their back porch, you can be very sure that they would be taken care of. So when I see the OLCC coming in and we see this market, this black market going on, I believe that they're going to start taking care of that. I hope somebody will. Okay, I just wanted to address that real quick. You know, the boundaries part of it, you know, I've competed in my whole life. And everybody, Dave, everybody knows I'm a competitor and I'm ready. I mean, you know, we're going to go and we're going to do the best we can. We're going to do the best customer service we can. We're going to provide the best products. We're going to have the cleanest, best looking establishment that we can do. And, you know, we'll let Whoopi Goldberg come in, let Willie Nelson come in, let Snoop Dogg come in, you know, we'll, you know, invite him in, you know, it'll be a circus, it'll be great, you know. But, you know, I think that what broke my heart was last week hearing this council talking about and everybody saying that our medical program is now a sinking ship, it's done. For a guy that contributes and helps out with cancer patients and everything that my wife and I do, it breaks my heart to think about that, because that's really, after 20 years of service to the state of Oregon and my country, why I'm doing what I do, is to help others. Sure, we got a business to do it. Sure, we've done it right. But to hear that, you know, we're going to lose a medical program, you know, it really hurts me. I think that, you know, I think we should go back to letting the OHA regulate us, let the OLCC regulate us. I would love to be able to have my medical shop right next door to my recreational shop. There's no reason why I shouldn't be able to do it with these ordinances gone now. I still want to have my mom and pop medical shop and do what we've always done, and, you know, be able to sell recreational next door in my big building. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Are there questions from counselors? All right. Thank you for coming.
Thank you.
We appreciate your testimony. All right, was there anyone else that wanted to testify on an item that is on the agenda? All right, I don't see anyone. We'll move along now to the consent calendar. Councillor McCoy, do you have a motion for us?
Yes, Madam Mayor. I move approval of the consent calendar with the following pull. That would be 3.3B by Councillor Bennett.
Second.
Make sure I've got them all here. That's it.
Okay. 3.3B by Councillor Bennett. Okay.
Want me to speak to those?
Was that it?
That's it.
Oh, all right. I thought that maybe there was going to be one earlier that we had.
Got pulled.
It pulled was off. Regarding the minutes. That's not necessary. We got that taken care of. All right. So it's been moved by Councillor McCoy and seconded by Councillor Bednarz to adopt the consent calendar with the one item that's pulled, which is item 3.3B. All those in favor of the motion. Oh, I'm sorry. You wanted to discuss the consent calendar.
Just let the folks out there watching what's on the consent calendar. We have the minutes from the June 8th and the June 16th meeting. As you're looking at the June 27th meeting, I'm sorry. And as you look at that, these were revised and corrected before the meeting. So these are the accurate minutes for those meetings. We have number 3.2A, which is an ordinance establishes the 3% tax on the sale of marijuana items to Salem, and we're referring that to Salem voters for the November 6th, 2016 general election. And adopting the measure and the explanatory statement and directing the city attorney to draft the ballot title. We have also one more item here, and that would be 3.3C. And these are the amendments to the Mill Creek Corporate Center Development District Order and the Mill Creek Infrastructure Agreement that we just discussed in the Urban Renewal Agency meeting. Basically just taking the infrastructure agreement, taking the annual cost of living, if you will, adjustment off of it, leaving that to the council with review by others to finally decide if there are going to be any increases, and moving it back to the level it was when this was first instituted in 2005 or six.
Good.
That is it, Madam Mayor.
All right, thank you. So the motion on the floor by, I'm sorry, there's a hand here. Councilor Anderson,
yeah,
yes.
I want to register a no vote against 3.3C on the items that I discussed earlier on the Urban Renewal Agency, mainly on the grounds that I don't know that the 3.3 the higher figure has actually stopped anybody from developing in Mill Creek. So I will vote yes on the rest of the consent calendar, but no on that particular item.
Okay. We don't have to pull it to do that. Okay. All right. Thank you. All right. The motion on the floor is to adopt the consent calendar as presented with the following pull of item 3.3B, pulled by Councillor Bennett. And we have a no vote by Councillor Anderson to be registered on item 3.3C. 3.3C, thank you. All right, all those in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, say nay. Motion carries, thank you. And please note the no vote registered by Councillor Anderson on item 3.3C. Okay, we will move on to our public hearings, and we have a public hearing for point A. Would the recorder please introduce the public hearing?
The Salem City Council will now hold a public hearing for the purpose of receiving public testimony regarding authorizing the approval of revenue bonds issued by the Hospital Facility Authority of the City of Salem, Oregon, in an aggregate principal amount not to exceed $13 million.
Thank you, and we have a staff report.
Yeah, thank you, Mayor Peterson. This is David Lacey from Finance, and I don't have a formal presentation tonight, but I did want to give a brief introduction to this public hearing and resolution. We've come forward to council with some of these before, called conduit financing for some improvements at Salem Hospital and also Capitol Manor. But this will be a project for the Yakima Valley Farm Workers Clinic. So for a little background, the Hospital Facility Authority of the City of Salem is a public authority created pursuant to state statute by the City Council in 1973. And the City Council appoints the board members, as several of you know, and the purpose of the authority is to acquire, own, lease, and otherwise dispose of hospital facilities and also authorize the issuance of bonds and other obligations. The authority recently approved a request from Yakima Valley Farm Workers Clinic, which is a 501c3 corporation, to help finance a multi-purpose clinic to be located at 255 Lancaster Drive Northeast. Section 147 of the Internal Revenue Code requires that qualified 501c3s obligations would be approved by the applicable elected representatives of the governmental unit having jurisdiction over the area in which the project is located, and also the applicable elected representatives of the government unit issuing such obligations. So normally City Council fulfills both of these obligations, but in this case, the site is actually located in unincorporated Marion County. So to fulfill the jurisdictional requirement, the Marion County Board of Commissioners held a public hearing on June 29th and issued an order consenting to the financing. In order to facilitate the actual debt issuance, the authority has requested that the City Council adopt Resolution 2016-31 to authorize this issuance for the limited purpose of allowing the revenue bonds to bear interest that's excludable from gross income for federal income tax purposes under the code. And so bonds issued by the authority are what's called conduit revenue bonds, and the proceeds from the bonds are loaned to a qualified private nonprofit entity, which in this case is Yakima Valley. And the revenue bonds will not constitute a debt or obligation for the City of Salem, nor shall the revenue bonds be payable from a tax of any nature levied upon any property within the City of Salem, nor within any other political subdivision of the State of Oregon. And we also do have tonight, too, for any questions, Peter Toop, who's the CFO from Yakima Valley Farm Workers Clinic, and also Douglas Goh, who's the bond counsel and special counsel for the Salem Hospital Facility Authority. With that, I'll hold until the public hearing.
All right, thank you very much. Appreciate your staff report. And we do have two gentlemen that have signed up for the public hearing. I'll call on Peter Toop first, and then followed by Doug Goh.
Good evening.
My Welcome.
My name is Peter Toop. I'm the CFO at Yakima Valley Farm Workers Clinic. I did sign up and I checked the I'm in favorite box. I kind of felt obligated. But I'm also here to answer any questions. I think the mayor and I believe you also at the commissioner meeting, and we went through this. And so basically, we already have a clinic on Lancaster. It's a small leased one, and we're looking at building a new structure. again, about $19 million, and let's see, 35,800 square feet. We'll have 10 physicians and mid-levels, also dental, 12 chairs with a couple of dentists and hygienists, a pharmacy, and a little bit for future growth. We also have behavioral health services we'll be delivering out of that. And so if there's any questions, I'd be happy to give them a shot.
Welcome, and I just want to clarify so everybody does know, yes, Councillor Lewis and I both sit on the Hospital Authority Advisory Board, I believe that we're called, and we're happy to do so. So we appreciate you coming to testify this evening. Councillor Anderson, you have your hand up.
Yes, I do. Thank you. I appreciate your coming, too. And I gather from the name of your clinic, are you specifically providing services to farm workers in Willamette Valley?
No, it's a bit of a misnomer these days. When it was founded in 1978, it was geared primarily towards agricultural farm workers. And now we have about 20 sites in Oregon and Washington, and by legal mandate, our doors are open to anybody, and we take Medicaid insurance. If you do not have any coverage, we'll still serve you on a sliding fee basis, but now it's much more urban.
And what is the people you see in your clinic, what is their vast makeup of them? I mean, what societies do you draw them from?
It varies greatly by site, you know, like for example in Spokane versus in Toppenish. But last year we did about 500,000 encounters, and probably about 80% ethnicity-wise are Hispanic, with the rest, I mean, anything from Russians to Caucasians, kind of mixing my labels here. But I'm going to avoid that. Yeah. So a rainbow of people we serve.
Good, good. Thank you very much. I appreciate the work you do.
Great, thank you.
Councillor Bednarz.
Quick question, quick statement. So I just want to confirm $19 million for the project and 35,000 square feet?
Yes, sir.
So that's about $542 a square foot?
Includes equipment, sorry. The actual construction is about $15 million. And then the rest is equipment and other things like that.
I'm just putting this, this council has had a lot of conversation about cost per square foot recently on different structures. This just puts kind of a framework around that. Thank you.
They're not numbers you really want to look at. Yeah. You know, if you have to look at them, you can't afford them, it appears.
Great. Well, the addition of medical care for people in this community inside the city of Salem, or whether they live inside or outside, is always a welcome addition. So thank you so much for bringing those services and expanding those services in our community.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Okay, Doug Goh, welcome.
Good evening, Madam Mayor, City Councilors. Pleasure to be with you. I'm Doug Goh with Orrick, Harrington & Sutcliffe, 1120 Northwest Cooch in Portland. Mr. Lacey did a great job of summarizing both what the resolution that's before you tonight. I'm appearing here as bond counsel and special counsel to the Hospital Facility Authority. Would just emphasize, as Mr. Lacey did, that the resolution by its terms and also under state statute, there is no liability on the part of the city with respect to these bonds. The Farmers Gers Clinic, the nonprofit corporation, is solely responsible for repayment of the bonds, and this hearing is solely being held because of the requirements of federal tax law. Be happy to address any questions the councilor or the mayor may have. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilors, questions? Councilor Dickey.
Thank you. And I don't know, this may be a question for staff. I'm not sure. I am in full support of this. I just want to be really clear. I understand why the city of Salem has input over this.
That's a great question, Madam Councilor. The reason is there, as Mr. Lacey noted, under the requirements of the federal tax code, in order to for a nonprofit corporation to take advantage of tax-exempt bonds and therefore the lower tax-exempt interest rates, there are two set of elected officials. You are the creating body under state law for the Hospital Facility Authority. And so as the applicable elected officials, that's why the city of Salem is taking action. Likewise, since Marion County, this is in the unincorporated area of Marion County, they had to, after a public hearing, give their approval in an order to do that. But that's the reason.
Okay, I understand now. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, any further questions? Councilor McCoy.
And these are tax-free municipal bonds, is that right?
That is correct, Councilor.
Okay, thank you.
All right. Great. No further questions. Thank you for coming.
Thank you, Mayor.
Appreciate you being here to testify. All right, are there questions for staff? No, we see none. I will close the public hearing. And I would entertain a motion from Councilor Lewis regarding the resolution.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I would move staff recommendation on agenda item 4.8.
Second.
Thank you. It's been moved by Councilor Lewis and seconded by Councilor Benars to adopt the resolution number 2016-31 as recommended by staff. Is there discussion? All right. All those in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, say nay. The motion carries unanimously. Thank you. Thank you very much. We have a second item under public hearing, and I understand from talking to the city attorney that the public hearing has actually been closed and there is no testimony to be received this evening. Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct. You had the hearing at your last meeting and adopted a motion for a decision, and this is just adoption of the written order.
Okay, thank you. All right, then Councilor Bennett.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Madam Mayor, I wasn't present for the public hearing on this issue, and I've not had a chance to review it, so I'll be abstaining on this issue.
Thank you. Did you say you're recusing yourself?
Recusing, then.
Yes, okay, thank you. I couldn't hear you because you...
Because I'm not talking into the mic.
Yes, that's right. Councilor Dickey.
Thank you. I'm going to make a similar statement because I was not present at the last meeting, and there were some technological issues over the weekend, and so I wasn't able to review the information. So I will also be recusing myself.
All right. Thank you. Okay. We have a motion on the floor. Is there any further discussion or comment?
Need a motion.
All right. Hearing none, we will call for the question.
We don't have a motion.
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought there was a motion.
No.
Well, I guess I'm just moving along too quickly here. All right. So, Councilor McCoy, I would ask for a motion regarding this item.
Yes, Madam Mayor. I move the staff recommendation that the City Council adopt the order to reverse the decision of the Planning Administrator for Site Plan Review Adjustment Case Number SPR/ADJ-1606.
Second.
Thank you. It's been moved by Councilor McCoy and seconded by Councilor Bednarz to adopt the staff recommendation following the City Council adoption of the order. All those in favor of the item, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, say nay.
Nay.
Motion carries with one no vote registered by Councilor Lewis. And please note the abstention of Councilors Bennett and Dickey. All right, thank you very much. We will now move to special orders of business, where we will entertain a motion from Councilor Bennett regarding item 3.3C.
Thank you, Madam Mayor.
3.3B? B.
Okay.
Oh, I am sorry.
No,
yes.
It's okay.
3.3B.
Good. I just want to make sure I had the right thing. Madam Mayor, I move the council authorize the city manager to apply for federal funds through the Salem-Keizer Area Transportation Study for the 10 projects outlined in the staff report on item 3.3B in the priority order listed.
Second.
Thank you. It's been moved by Councilor Bennett and seconded by Councilor Bednarz to approve the staff recommendation on item 3.3B. And is there discussion?
Madam Mayor,
first Councilor Bennett.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I would forego any discussion on my part in favor of hearing Mr. Fernandez kind of run through this list so we can take a look at what issues are on the table.
Great. All right. Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor. Peter Fernandez, once again, Public Works Director. Let me start by clarifying that the list is not priority, it's alphabetical. So it would be up to council to set a priority if you would like. The first five are the highest priority, but within that listing, they are not prioritized. They're just alphabetical at that point.
I hope you'll explain the priority order. When you put something in highest priority, I would think you'd have them in some order related to priority.
Just alphabetical after that.
It's an interesting use of priority.
I think what we were trying to say is that those are the projects that we feel have the best chance of being funded. They're also, if you look back at the financial summary table on pages 3 and 4, you see that those are projects that have the most secure match funding, because these would be federally funded projects. We have to come up with at least 10.27% match for them. If council wishes to prioritize, what you would be doing is providing Councilor Lewis some direction, since he is your representative on the Salem-Keizer Area Transportation Study Policy Committee. If we just apply for them, then there is some negotiating, some discussion, some deliberation that takes place at the committee, where the other communities that are part of SCATS also have a shot. So Turner, Keizer, Marion, and Pope Counties Transit District and School District.
Yes, Councilor Bennett, and then Councilor Anderson, and then Councilor McCoy.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Do we need, Tim, to add to the motion a priority listing? Is that what you're suggesting?
If you would like to provide Councilor Lewis with that direction, then that would be appropriate. If you simply want us to apply for either the 5 or the 10, then it would be as it lays out once the SCATS Policy Committee starts deliberating them.
Well, I'm not sure whether to amend the motion or I do think that having the Center Street Bridge seismic retrofit study at the top of the list would be a real good choice. And I'm real partial to that Union Street family-friendly bikeway. And I mean, I could run through the list like that, yeah. But I guess I would, more than anything, I'd like to get that Center Street Bridge seismic retrofit study at the top of the list.
So if I may, I can just kind of tell you about each project just very briefly. So the 12th Street Widening Project is a project that is funded for construction. It's scheduled to be constructed, I think, year after next. We're a little short on money, so we'd like to find the extra money. This project already qualifies for federal funding, so we'd like to get that done. Center Street seismic retrofit is actually a very small project, very small in terms of dollar value. It'd be a partnership with ODOT, so they were just looking for a little match money, a little money from this program, which we think it's a good thing to do. Hilfiker Lane construction is just an extension of Hilfiker, and it would the match would be funded with transportation SDCs. We've been talking about it for years. Whether it goes or not goes, that's, the neighborhood has been for it and against it over time. McGilchrist Street widening, the plan there would be to seek $2 million in right-of-way acquisition funds, and then we would use the urban renewal monies for the match. We think that's an important project. If we get that amount for right-of-way acquisition, we feel that we stand a better chance at being successful with our Tiger grant application, because we'll be 60% designed, we'll have all of our environmental permits, and we'll have not all of the right-of-way, but a good amount of the right-of-way acquired. And then Union Street is a priority project in the downtown plan. It also has urban renewal funds associated with it, so this would be a nice leverage for those projects. When you get down for the additional applications, 25th Street multi-use path is a nice to have. It's also a bike facility. We don't really have money identified for that. We think we'd use some of our gas tax, our bikeway gas tax allocation monies. I don't know that we have $350,000 in the bank, so we'd be a little harder pressed. Brush College is a project that the council had authorized as a savings project for streets and bridges. If we were to apply and get that, we would recommend coming back and using streets and bridges savings to do that project. And then the rest of them, the other three, really do not have any monies associated with them, as it shows on Table 8. So again, we could apply for them, we could see how it lays out, but in terms of limiting the discussion and limiting the staff work, my suggestion would be go for the top five, and maybe if you wanted to, if one of the bottom five move you, that'd be fine, but the top five, there's more than enough there.
Mm-hmm. Madam Mayor,
yes.
Yeah, thank you. The question I guess I would have on this then is really of Councilor Lewis, because he's the person that goes in and negotiates this. Mm-hmm. Would the councilor need priority or want priority listing, or would he rather just work with this list and he understands what we're looking for?
Councilor Lewis?
I would prefer to have it be the way it is, and
okay.
Quite frankly, all five of them are the highest priority.
Yeah.
All okay. of them. Okay. And I don't want to give in to any of them.
Okay, great, thank you.
Councilor Anderson?
Thank you. I agree that these are all terrific projects. I think part of the problem is they were said in superlative, not comparative. So in actuality, these are higher priority projects because the top five are higher than the bottom five. Would that be a correct statement?
Correct.
Okay. I agree with Councilor Lewis. I think all five are extremely important, but you know, my personal favorite is the Union Street one, but and I think part of that is because I also Center Street Bridge is my next one, but the Center Street Bridge project, it sounds, Director Fernandez, like ODOT is going to be pursuing this as well.
Right. ODOT was seeking, to my chagrin, was seeking for us to help fund the you know, a portion of the match. It's their facility. They should match the entirety. But I grit my teeth and said, okay, we'll participate.
We're sort of back
because
to the last.
That's an important.
We're sort of back to
us.
The last meeting that they're the state and we're not on the other project. you know, but my point there is there's going to be somebody else there from ODOT saying this is an important project to us. We want it. So the other projects appear to be ones that are just going to be the city they're talking about it. So that's maybe something that Councilor Lewis can keep in mind as he looks at that.
Councilor Dickey? Oh, I'm sorry, Councilor Bednarz, and then Councilor Dickey.
So the first part, my question was answered, and that had to do with priority. I'm happy with the five and five the way it is. I think I've been on that committee, the MWAC and SCATS, and it's he'll get his point across perfectly well. Second, I just wanted to compliment staff. This is a great way to go. This is exactly what we've been needing to do, is to leverage the dollars that we have when we pair it up and use federal money, which is also our money. It's money that we send to Washington, and it comes back to us.
Yep.
So, but I'm glad to see the leverage. I'm glad to see something happening if we can get this funding. Thank you.
Councilor Dickey.
Thanks, Mayor. Just a quick correction. I don't see any of these projects in Northgate neighborhood, and that says on the staff report. I know it's just a little minor detail, but I just wanted to mention that. So I believe the River Road signal probably is in Highland. So unless I'm not seeing, I mean, it's a small map, so unless I'm not seeing that correctly, I think it would be important, though, to correct that so that it, at the point that a neighborhood association needs to be visited with the information, it gets to the right neighborhood association.
Thank you, Councilor. I think you're correct.
Well, I would like to just add a comment. I do really want to prioritize of the five highest priority. I would like to rank those, and I'm looking at that list particularly in view of economic development opportunity as a tremendous impact on our community. And I certainly see McGilchrist Street as a tremendously important economic thoroughfare. It is a gateway to the airport. It is an important road that will be more and more so used as an alternative to that section of Mission, which is often clogged. And I know that we have had the McGilchrist Street improvements on our list for many years, and I would just like to see that when we do go to the prioritization at SCATS, that there's a strong recommendation for that, because I do also remember my time on SCATS and MWAC for that matter, where the people on the committee are going to look to our representative, and I think Councillor Lewis for his diligence to represent us there, and as did Councillor Bednarz previously. I would just like to really speak to the funding that's needed for McGillcrest. It's something that holds back the economic development of many of the businesses in that area because transportation is so difficult. So that's my plea for that one. Any other comments regarding the prioritization and the issues? Okay, we'll move to the question. Then the motion on the floor is to adopt the, go back to this a second here.
That's always easier.
I'm sorry?
He's whispering staff recommendation.
It was, Madam Mayor, it was to authorize the city manager to apply for federal funds for the Salem-Keizer area transportation study for the following five projects and then listing the five highest priority projects.
Good. Thank you very much. And it was seconded by Councillor Bednarz. All right. Any further discussion? All those in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed, say nay. Motion carries unanimously. Thank you. I don't believe we had another poll, did we?
No.
Okay. Information reports are in your binder or in your on your laptops. Were there any questions regarding information reports? All right, seeing none, we'll move to ordinances. And the first, would the recorder please introduce the first ordinance, which is item 7.1A, ordinance bill number 1216.
Ordinance Bill 1216, an ordinance relating to marijuana, amending Salem Revised Code Sections 31.001, 31.005, 31.010, 31.015, 31.020, 31.025, 31.030, and repealing Salem Revised Code Sections 31.035, 31.040, 31.045, 31.050, 31.055, 31.060, 31.065, 31.070, 31.075, 31.080, 31.085, 31.090, 31.095, 31.100, and 31.105.
Thank you. Is there a motion? Let's see, Councillor. Oh, yes, excuse me. We had a time for that earlier in the evening, actually. Not at this point, I'm sorry. Yeah, I'm sorry, not at this point. Thank you. Thank you. All right, so at this point, Councilor McCoy, do you have a motion?
Yes, Madam Mayor. I move that we advance Ordinance Bill number 1216, which establishes a registration system for marijuana businesses and repeals the licensing program for medical marijuana facilities to second reading.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
All right, it's been moved by Councilor McCoy and seconded by Councilor Bednarz. Is there discussion? Councilor McCoy.
One thing I want to bring up is we were working at last meeting. One of the issues that we still haven't dealt with and is the issue of whether or not we allow these types of businesses in downtown Salem.
Mm-hmm.
Currently, we don't. I know that we didn't get to that the last meeting. We've got a hearing coming up in the first part of August where we're dealing with where the grow sites will be and those kind of issues.
Mm-hmm.
And at that point, I will introduce an amendment onto that ordinance to at least bring that up for discussion so we can get to that point. The reason I'm bringing it up, I'm concerned we don't want somebody running down there and leasing some space while we're still considering we're banning it in that area of the town. So I want that on public record. That's still under consideration. It's whether that happens or not remains to be seen with discussion, but it's something I think we need to address before we end this whole saga.
All right, thank you very much. Councillor Bednarz.
So do I understand this correctly after the first read? Is this setting it for public hearing? Have we done this already? It's a procedural thing. I think the city attorney might be.
We've already done the public hearing.
So there's nothing to be continued at this point?
If I may, then this particular ordinance, there has not been a public hearing scheduled, and staff isn't recommending one. Of course, council can schedule a public hearing on it if they wish.
I apologize for giving you the wrong information. Okay. All right, so it's been, Councilor Anderson.
Thank you. I have two questions towards staff, and Councilor Benner and I were discussing this. Currently, the sale of recreational and medical marijuana is banned in the downtown district?
Mm-hmm.
Yes?
That's correct.
Okay. No, that's why I ask. I know medical is recreational.
Well, recreational is only allowed under the early sales program from a medical facility.
Got it. And so that's why Councilor McCoy made the statement he did. Mm-hmm. Then my next question relates to the OLCC regulation. You know, we've heard about the 1,000-foot issue here of one shop to another shop, not the 1,000-foot issue to parks or Head Start or schools or any of that stuff. Mm-hmm. Is that the sort of regulation that OLCC on their own could come up with, or is that something that is really not something that they would be making rules about the siting of the shops?
I'm not positive whether the OLCC has the authority under the statute to make that sort of restriction, but you know they've been working on the rules for quite a while, and I think if they were going to do that, they already would have.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Councilor Bennett.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I'm pleased that we're talking about the downtown under another apparently germane. We can do it under this other ordinance we're talking about without any problem. We can deal with this downtown issue.
Right. The council is currently at a prior meeting, did first reading of an ordinance that would allow marijuana grow facilities or manufacturing facilities, I believe in the IC zone, to
yes.
expand that under conditional use. And that ordinance you would be able to engross or amend to include a restriction.
In any zone?
Correct.
Okay. So really what the next discussion is how this can be zoned in. We can open up any zoning question we want in the next.
Well, I mean, basically, under the Oregon land use law, you send a notice out to everyone regarding you're proposing a certain ordinance to amend your code. Any changes you make to that ordinance that's different from the notice, it's got to be within the scope of what that ordinance
that's
is. You say any zoning change, no. But within the rubric of marijuana regulation, I think you're pretty close.
I just want to make sure that we're not foreclosing any opportunity relative to downtown, because so our notice will go out saying we will include the discussion of downtown.
Well, that notice has already gone out. You've already done first reading of the ordinance. But if you wanted to prohibit, my opinion, if you wanted to prohibit recreational and medical marijuana dispensaries in the downtown, you can do it by amending the ordinance you've already done first reading on. So, yes.
This ordinance.
No, there's a separate zoning ordinance that talks about, you know, marijuana grow manufacturing facilities and allowing them in the IC zone. We can amend that ordinance when it comes back to you.
And there won't be any challenge to it because it is not
a valid challenge.
Growing in IC zones, right? I mean,
I think we're in very solid legal footing by amending it in that way. And there may be a challenge, but I don't think it would be valid.
Okay, because I'm kind of concerned because it is the germane, or I don't know what you'd call it. To me, it's germaneness of it sounds a little off.
Zoning.
It's just, well, then you could talk all zoning, but I think what the city attorney's saying is you can't talk all zoning issues.
Marijuana business zoning, I think it's within the same subject matter, so I think you're okay.
Okay. The other question I've got, I guess, is relative to this decision not to hold a public hearing. I did miss that part. I apologize. What was the reasoning for no public hearing?
Just a bit of a time crunch to get this adopted, because if you're going to go ahead and proceed with recreational regulation, it's getting very close to the point where the OLCC will start issuing their licenses for recreational growers. So we need to decide one way or the other if you're going to regulate them. So as opposed to scheduling it for a public hearing, I opted to proceed to first reading. And if you want to schedule a public hearing, we can do that.
Well, this sounds like what we've done is essentially we no longer are regulating it. We're just turning it over to OLCC, so why not have a public hearing about whether or not that's the best idea? Do you see what I'm saying? Does that make sense?
It's certainly up to you.
Yeah, we could
change
it.
At the last council
meeting, instead of going to second reading.
At the last council meeting, we had lengthy discussion about this and lengthy discussion about regulation versus not regulating by the city of Salem and leaving that to the OLCC, just as we do allow them to regulate alcohol. And so our conclusion as a council that we're here that night was that OLCC is in the business of regulating, let them do it.
I don't want to re-litigate that because I know you spent hours talking about this, and I'm sure we're very tired and frustrated when you hit the end of the point where you passed this. But
I don't know that I'd say that. I don't think I would say.
I'll
that.
I'll tell you. I'm really concerned, Madam Mayor, because I have watched OLCC regulate, and I, on a regular basis, have had to deal with OLCC's lack of regulation or inability to regulate certain kinds of businesses and the associated activity with them, and that we've all been frustrated by it at various times with having OLCC regulate the entire liquor license area. That's my only concern, and I don't know if that came up. And that's the various kinds of clubs that have liquor licenses and are allowed to locate in various parts of the community, and we cannot zone them under, you know, they get their license like anyone else, and there's just concerns there.
That's not the OLCC's issue. That's the Supreme Court ruling. They can't do anything.
Well, I just want to make sure that it got full hearing. It sounds like it really got a full hearing, Madam Mayor, that everybody understands what they just gave up in terms of their ability to regulate this. Okay.
Councilor Anderson.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. While we didn't have a public hearing, we had lots of people testifying, the citizen comments on items that are on the agenda that weren't scheduled for public hearing. And we had some of the same people who are here today, or were here today, and others in the industry. And it was quite a long discussion. And we asked a bunch of questions of them. And then when it came time to discuss this, we sure had a lot of discussion among the council and also with staff on these kind of issues. And so I'm normally one who wants public hearings rather than not, but we pretty much had one, I think. And I think it was pretty well vetted.
Mm-hmm. Okay, other comments by councilors? All right, then we have, refresh my memory, a motion on the floor by Councilor McCoy and seconded by Councilor Bednarz. We're ready for the question. All those in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, say nay.
Nay.
The motion carries with one no vote registered by Councilor Nanke. All right, thank you. We have no second readings. Is there anyone signed up for public comment?
Yes.
No trading sheets.
Yes, you can talk down.
Excuse me. Actually, this is the time for agenda item, for public comment on other than agenda items this evening. So that would preclude you. We had the time for you to speak, and that has passed. Now, we're going to move on, and Tim Cowan has signed up to speak on something other than an agenda item, and I was given a handout. Mr. Cowan, is this the handout that you have provided having to do with Rule 15 public comment? Was this from you?
Yes.
Yes, Mayor.
Oh, okay, thank you. I just wanted to draw to people's attention what they have in front of them that has to do with your testimony. Welcome.
Thank you. Oh, okay. Which one goes to the next one? This one?
Yes.
Okay. Mayor, City Council, for the record, my name is Tim Cowan, and I reside at 3160 Dogwood. Can we dim the lights a little bit? Can you see that? Oh, you can see it. Okay. On the first slide is a crosswalk at the hospital. It's on the hospital campus. Mm-hmm. The speed is 10 miles an hour.
It's the same width as the one on Mission Street by Bush Park. However, it has a turn lane, so there's a place for the cars to go to turn into the parking structure. It has a flashing unit on it, and the best I could tell when I went out there is it's automatic. You don't have to push a button. When someone gets into a certain proximity of it, it goes off. And you'll notice, too, before I go to the next picture, it's parking on each side. All there is parking. Now, when we look at the site on Mission Street, you'll notice that the speed is 25 miles an hour, not 10. It's the same width as the one at the hospital. There is no turn lane. There's no light flashing when someone's crossing it or attempting to cross it. Now, different than the hospital one where it has parking on both sides, this one has a park on one side that's used a lot, and on the other side is where they're having a rehab park that we're putting in with a hospital. I think that's different than going from parking lot to parking lot. Now, the question I have of you, too, is, well, there's two of them. The first one is, if you're an island, I've mentioned this once before, if you're an island, are you in the crosswalk? Okay. I took this picture just to show you that across how much visibility, I guess, there is from when you're crossing over, but that's the reason why I took it. While I'm trying to adjust to take the picture, that's what I found. At 25 miles an hour, I think it's going to be really hard for someone to know if that car is slowing down or not. Oh, wait a minute. I took these pictures this summer, and I'll do this real quick. You'll notice the family coming down the street, down the sidewalk. And then you couldn't see those people until I came right up on it because the visibility is blocked. So the only thing I ask is for you to consider, how can we make that safer for people there? And maybe the hospital gives us a little bit of an idea of what can happen there. Okay. Now, I'm short
Thank
of time.
Thank you. I'm sorry. Yes, you are. You're out of time. Can you wrap up really fast?
Well, I talked about the crosswalk. The only last thing I had with you was a loan application. And the reason why I gave that to you, you've had it before, is when we talk about the bond issue, what I wanted to do is look at that as if I was approving a loan for $40 or $50 million. I could only go to $50 million when I was with the bank. That was the house limit. Is if I could get up here and testify and go, I would approve a $50 million loan based on this criteria, that might have an impact on whether people would pass a bond.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay. I do have to call your time. I just do have to. Are there questions from councilors? Councilor Lewis?
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Connell, for coming down. Could you go back to your very first slide that showed the street you mentioned on the hospital property? Salem has different designations for streets, such as collector streets. Can you tell me what the designation is for this street and also Mission Street?
I do not. I'm sorry. No.
Okay.
It's on the campus.
I'd like that question answered by staff if I could.
Certainly.
It's significant.
Councillor, this is a private street. It was previously a... it might have been a local street. It might have been. I don't recall what its designation was, but today that right of way was vacated, and the hospital operates it as a private street. Mission Street, I believe, in that segment is it's definitely an arterial. I don't recall whether it's a major arterial or a minor arterial. We're very constrained on Mission Street throughout that area because of the historic properties on the south, the residential properties on the north, and then obviously the hospital campus. So So, you know, we try and work within those constraints.
Thanks. That answers my question.
Okay. Thank you. Councillor Anderson, followed by, I'm sorry, Councillor Benjamin, and then Councillor Anderson.
Thanks for coming down, Mr. Cowan. So some of these very good questions, I like it, on this application. Are you kind of alluding to putting this on as an explanation on the bond for voting for or against support for the bond?
Well, my first reason for doing this is if I could testify to you and go, based on the risk criteria, I would approve this for a loan under these conditions. I'm going to have to make an assessment of risk, and because I can't afford to have this not to be paid accordingly. Mm-hmm. So I think it might help people who are kind of questionable on the bond.
Right.
If I could get up and say, this is what I would do. And it might be helpful for you too, if there's one or two things that would make a difference to me, that you might want to address that. And I hope that finance application, if you will, would give you some areas to look into.
Right. Had you an opportunity to talk to staff at all about some of these questions? Because I'm thinking that there's probably answers to these now.
I can talk to them anytime you want.
Yeah.
Anytime.
Okay.
Okay, Councillor Anderson had a question, I think.
Thank you. Yeah, it's not so much a question for Mr. Cowan, although thanks for coming down. I'm going back to the first slide and note that all the pictures, are except for this one, are on Mission Street, and Mr. Cowan is right that the one at the corner of Mission and Church is right by what we're now going to have a playground on the northeast corner of that. And we've got a major park on the other side, and it's a busy street. And I know that the Public Works Department will be working with the hospital to make sure that we're taking care of the pedestrians, especially the young children there. I ride my bike through that intersection all the time, and it's already somewhat problematic now, and it's going to get worse with people in the park there. So I'm sure that's something you'll be looking at to make sure we can keep the citizens safe, so I don't have to talk about pedestrian deaths anymore. Thank you.
Great. Thank you. All right. Thank you, Mr. Cowan. Appreciate you coming down. Councilors, there's nothing further on the agenda. This meeting is adjourned. Wow, this makes up for